Hello, I'm Ellen Horan, President and CEO of the Greater Reading Chamber of Commerce and Industry, and with me today is Eric Savage, President from Freedom Auto Group, for this week's Member Spotlight. Welcome, Eric.
Well, thank you very much, Ellen. Glad to be here.
Great. So I'm glad you're here. You were just down in Washington, D.C. for a very cool award. Why don't you tell us about that?
Yeah, well, thank you very much. Thank you also to the Chamber for the nomination. But yes, we were able to win that Small Business Award from the Chamber on a national level, which is a very exciting thing to do. The best part about being in Washington, though, was being with all the other winners throughout the country. There's 100 of them throughout the United States.
And only 100,
that's right. Correct. So we felt like we were a very small, reserved enclave there at the event. But just interacting with all these amazing business leaders and a million different businesses and hearing about their triumphs and their trials and the things that they work on, it was really fantastic.
Yeah.
One thing that was in common was every one of the business leaders that I've met who won the Blue Ribbon Award, they all have a really deep philosophy about why they are there. Not there at the event, but why they're there on the planet, why they work, why they invest time, effort, and energy. It was really remarkable.
Right.
These weren't the typical business people of, I'm in this for a return on investment. These were people that said, I'm in this to do something significant.
Right. Well, and that's when we make nominations, that this is the second year that we've done that, we're charged with companies that are growing, that are successful, and that are giving back to the community.
I thought it was just my good looks.
No, that wasn't it at all.
Oh, well.
But we'll talk a little bit about giving back to the community, because I know that's important to you. But first, let's talk about how you got into the business that you're in.
Yeah, so there's a novel coming about it, but I won't give you the full 384 pages. In short, I was in high school and approaching my college years, and in my family we had a deal. I had to pay 50% of my own education, and which is very fair. So I set out to find a way to make the money. I had no intention of being in the car business. I wanted to go to college. I was a biology major. I really wanted to go into medicine or the medical fields, perhaps research or something. And the bottom line is that the only way I could raise that kind of money was by selling cars in my family's business. Mm-hmm. And that's what I did. I spent the summer selling cars. I spent every weekend, fall break, Christmas break, spring break, every moment I could selling cars to keep the money flowing from my tuition. Well, I did exceptionally well, and I was able to make the money. And I did it the next summer and just kept following through. And somewhere along the way in the education, I got bit by the bug and determined that I already knew what I wanted to do. I really wanted to be in this business. Mm-hmm. So I joined the family business and was part of the family business when we were two dealerships, Savage Auto Group in the Reading area. And I became an M&A guy for the family. I just went out and started buying dealerships that seemed to fit our model or what we were looking for, and brought us up to 9 dealerships. So by the time I was finished with Savage Auto Group, and in 2006, I departed Savage Auto Group and went out on my own and started my own dealership group, and it's called Freedom Auto Group. I love my family, but I did get my freedom.
Well, there you go.
So that's really what that's about. So I had Freedom Toyota in Hamburg, Freedom Hyundai in Hamburg, and then that was in 2006, and then in 2009, in the middle of the world melting down, I bought two more dealerships out in Harrisburg. I bought a Freedom Toyota of Harrisburg and Freedom Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram of Harrisburg.
Right.
So those are that's where we're at now. So we're 4 dealerships.
Awesome.
We sell about 5,000 to 6,000 cars a year. We've got roughly 250 to 270 employees, counting the part-timers that come in and out of our business, and love what we do every day.
Yeah. Well, and this must have been an incredible year this past year with the hail.
Yes. So certainly for our Hamburg dealerships, we were influenced by that. You know, at any given moment, I have, just for example, 300 Toyotas available at any given moment. And I remember the end of June, I had 7 cars on my lot.
I bet.
I had 7 cars left because everything was sold. We weren't affected in Hamburg by the hailstorm directly, but all of our customers were.
Yeah, so thank God you didn't lose your inventory.
Yes, right. Yeah,
wonderful.
Indeed. We were fortunately spared with that.
Yeah. Well, there's a lot of people riding around in very nice cars this year.
They're all, although I still see a bunch with hail damage too.
Yeah, I've seen that too.
Out there still,
I've seen that too. All right, so let's talk a little bit about your giving back to the community, because I know that's very important to you, and I know you like to go by the slogan that I'm in the life improvement business.
That's correct. So. And it's less of an I statement, it's more of a we, because everybody at Freedom believes that you could get any of our associates at 3 a.m. out of a dead sleep and ask them, what business are you in? And they will say life improvement business, because this is a mantra for us. We eat, sleep, breathe it every single day. We really believe it, and it's the beauty of it is we're surrounded by people like that. But here's the real deal is that, look, anyone can sell a car. Anyone can service a car. And what we didn't want to be is we didn't want to be a business that was just about making profit. Look, we got bills. We've got to make a profit. And we want to pay our taxes, and we want to do all the things we need to do that you need cash flow for. But that as a purpose didn't seem rich enough for us, frankly. And so while our function is to sell cars and service cars, our purpose is much greater. Our purpose is to truly enrich and better the world in which we live, and especially the people. And so when we take a look at that holistic view and we start thinking about it, well, from a customer perspective, how can we truly make the engagement a life-improving situation? We improve people's lives with our products and the way we service them every day. But can we go beyond that? Well, we improve our associates' lives. This is interesting, not by just giving them a good job at a competitive wage, but by giving them a job that has a purpose. It's not just about income, but about living a life of giving. That's really enriching their lives by being givers, helping them become givers. And then most significantly is the community aspect, is how can we improve the lives of the people in our community? And this is probably the area I think that we excel at. In fact, my wife will often tell me, you know, you get more excited about your community initiative than you do about selling cars any day of the week, and she's absolutely right. The business has really become a vehicle, pun intended, for giving back to the community. It's really what it's become for us, is this way, this object we can leverage to do great things. And so that's what we look for every day and every way possible. And then when we find these opportunities to give back, it's not about writing a check, although we know all the nonprofits need money. What it's really about is how can we help a nonprofit make their cause even better? How can we help them sharpen their own blade or give them more exposure? One of our core competencies is marketing. We're very good at marketing. Car dealers have to be. And so how can we bring marketing prowess to a nonprofit and raise money for them at the same time? And we find very creative ways to express that and help them get the word out for themselves more in ways that they're less accustomed to. It's interesting because I've done a lot of board work in a nonprofit community, and I'm certainly proud of that time. And while there are many business people who will say, rightly so, that nonprofits sometimes need to act more like businesses, I would say that I've taken a lot of my nonprofit learning and brought it into my business. And somebody recently gave me the most extraordinary compliment when I was telling them about life improvement business model and how we run our business, and they said, Eric, you run your business like a nonprofit. Because we're so philosophy-driven, we're so culture-driven, and we really understand our purpose more than anything. And that's the best compliment I've ever gotten. And the truth is that I really stole all that from my nonprofit work by looking and studying nonprofits and seeing how they are so mission-driven and being able to bring that mission into our business.
Right. Excellent.
Yes, thank you.
Well, I think that's wonderful advice for your fellow chamber members. I do have one question for you. What is with car dealer radio ads?
Are you talking about mine in particular?
All of them.
Yes.
All of them.
So the deal is this, is that if you do a radio ad and you're not annoying, you're not getting the audience. That's as simple as that. So I have a character or a caricature of myself that I portray as Mr. Freedom on my radio ads, and I have a blast doing them. People all the time are saying, oh, I heard you on the radio. And the very first question I ask is, did it annoy you? Because I really wanted to annoy you. And if it's not annoying you, it's not working. Because the truth is that if we're not hitting with that edge that makes somebody say like, oh my gosh, not this again, then we're not getting heard. And if I do nice ones and friendly ones and sweet ones, no one hears them. But when I have that little edge to it, a little craziness to it, all of a sudden I get a lot of recognition for it and people show up.
All right. Well, you've had a lot of tips for your fellow chamber members today on marketing and building a culture and having a passion for a mission, not being counter to being profitable.
Right. You can be both.
Yeah, I believe so, too. Anything else you would like to share?
No, I would just say, you know, for all small businesses, is that social media has tremendous levering power and can really help build a brand. It's very inexpensive, and we've used it, I think, very, very well, especially in our partnerships with nonprofits. And so it's a really great way, and I'd love to see more businesses take advantage of that and find ways to use it creatively.
Yeah, they're slowly learning which vehicles are productive.
Yeah. It's a challenge. Yeah, 95% of what we've done in social media is wrong. The 5% we've done right has been home runs, though. Yeah. And so it's been a great learning process.
All right. So before we sign off, which ones would you consider the home runs?
Well, it's not so much which channel.
So an example.
Facebook, Instagram, Twitter are all valuable, but doing hashtag campaigns has been extremely lucrative for the nonprofits we work with. So we monetize a hashtag usage that includes our name, and that's how we develop sponsorship. And the results have been phenomenal when we've done that. People understand hashtags. It's easy to count and validate a hashtag. And people love posting photos, and then tagging it with a hashtag is simple. And it's just done wonderful things. And it expands everybody's brand in the process.
Very good. Thanks for sharing your tips and your expertise.
Sure.
And thank you for being a member of the Chamber.
Happy to be here. Thanks, Ellen.